Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Today we're going to be in Job 19. We must remember there's a series of three cycles. Job 3 friends are going to speak, and then Job answers each one of them. So therefore, chapter 19 is reaction to chapter 18, which is Bildad's speech. But 19 is very similar to 16 because Job is answering these same old questions. The friends are espousing traditional Old Testament theology, which is, if God loves you, you're going to be healthy, wealthy, and wise. If you sin, God's going to give you barrenness or leprosy or problems or poverty or whatever. And so the three friends are saying, come on, Job, somewhere you have really blown it. And Job's saying, look, I may have sinned as a young person, I'm sure I have faults, but nothing to reap this kind of havoc in my life. And so the friends are saying, Job, you're rocking the boat. Quit challenging traditional theology just because of what's happened to you. Who do you think you are anyway? And that's been the whole set through here. Now, notice it says, then Job responds. Now, 2 through 6... our reaction to Job's three friends. And he's saying, hey, you all have really been ugly to me. Now, Job has four pressures, we need to see. Number one is his three friends, instead of being supporters, they have been aggressively attacking him. Number two, God has been silent. Job has called out to God, and God has not answered. Number three, Job's family and friends have rejected him, and that's in verses 13 through 22. And then finally, the physical disease itself is so debilitating, so draining, so abhorrent and miserable, that is a constant irritation factor in his life. Now, notice in verse 4 where, for the sake of argument, Job says, even if I have truly erred. Now, this is a syntax relationship in Greek that means, in Hebrew that means, for the sake of argument, I'm going to concede that I've sinned, but even if I had, it's none of your business. Now that's kind of the way that Job is reacting to them. In verse 6 it says, know then that God has wronged me and has enclosed his net around me. Now, in chapter 18, verse 8, Bildad asserts that the wicked will be caught in their own net. And what Job is saying is, God's net is what I'm trapped in, not my own personal wickedness. So you see, again, Job is asserting his innocence. Now, he believes in God's justice, but he said, God has done this to me, and God is acting unfairly towards me, and I want to present my case to him. And that's basically what we have through here. The description of how God has wronged Job is really in verse 7 through 12. Job goes into more detail on how God has unjustly afflicted him. I cry violence, but I get no answer. I shout for help. There is no justice. These are accusations against God. He's saying, God's given me the cold shoulder. God's given me the deaf ear. God is reacting in unjust ways toward me. And when I call for help, he is not responding. Notice in verse 9 where it says, he has stripped my honor from me. Now, this word honor is the Hebrew word kabod. Now, kabod can mean glory. Its basic etymology is to be heavy. It's a commercial term. And therefore, it's talking about that which is due. And so what we have here basically is Job saying, I've lost my good name, or maybe I've lost the joy of my children. One of those seems to be what's involved here. Notice where it says, I've removed the crown from my head. Now, many times in the Bible, clothing, be it a crown or stripped of, like taking clothing off, is used as a metaphor of spiritual characteristics. Isaiah 59:17 is a good one for that. And several times in the book of Job, this is used. Now, let me go to verse 13 for a minute. And I just want to go through all the people who have rejected Job. And think of this list and think of you. His brothers, his acquaintances, his relatives, his intimate friends, those who are in his house, which includes his maids, his servant, and his wife, his own brothers. Now, the first one may mean national, racial. This means his own blood kin. young children, not his own, but others, my intimate business associates, and look at verse 21 again, my friends. Every one of these just were trying to keep Job at arm's length and saying, something have you, boy. You've done something wrong. We don't have anything to do with you. We may catch what you've got. And so that's the idea through here of all these interpersonal relationships that are disrupted. Now, notice if you would, in verse 20 where it says, I have escaped only by the skin of my teeth. Well, that's a very popular cultural proverb for us in America. Escape by the skin of my teeth. And when we use that, we're saying something like, I barely escaped. I just got by. But if you'll look at the context here, that is not saying that at all. He's speaking something here. If you notice the 20A, he's talking about the problem and misery of his physical disease. And in the midst of that problem with that physical disease, what he's saying is, I've escaped death, or I've escaped whatever. So the way we use that proverb is not the way the Bible is using it in context. That's what I'm trying to say. Now, let me skip down to verse 23 through 29 and spend most of my time here, because this is where the heart of this chapter is. And this is where the famous quote that we're so used to out of Job comes from. Now, in 1326, God has a record book. Now, I've told you that there are two places in the Bible that seems to talk about this record book. One up in the book of Daniel, I believe it's chapter 7, verse 10. And then in Revelation 20:12, it talks about the books were opened. And we learn that one of them is the book of remembrances, or the book of deeds. Now that can be used both positively and negatively, both men in their righteousness and men in their wickedness. But the book of life is that special book where the names of God's people are recorded in. When Moses said, take me out of the book thou hast written, that apparently was the book of life. Now, God's got a book in 1326, and Job in 23 and 24, he says, I want a book. I want a book where I can indelibly write what has happened to me, because this is totally unfair, and I want all men to know it. Well, Job is getting rather pushy, to tell you the truth. He wants it on an iron stylus and lead. He wants it permanently. He wants it forever. They are engraved in a rock forever. Job wants a record of how he feels he's been mistreated by God. Now, in verse 25 through 27 is this famous quote that I'm going to look at in detail. Okay? First of all, as for me, now I want you to take a pencil and circle in your Bible between verse 25 and 27 the number of times the personal pronoun I, me, my, myself is used. And it will amaze you. I think it's 11 or 12 times. This is a very intensely personal relationship that Job has with God. And his thoughts are connected with God and what God's doing to him. Think through here. But as for me, I know. Now this know is very important. We are basically Western culture. And for us, to know speaks of cognitive knowledge. I know that 2 and 2 is 4. I know that a certain thing happened in history. I know my phone number. So it's cognitive. It's mental. But basically, Hebrew is primarily relational. And a good place to see that is Genesis 4, fourth chapter, verses 1 and 2, where it says, and Adam knew Eve, and she conceived. And therefore, intimate sexual relationships are used with the term know. So when it says, I know, we're not speaking about, I think, maybe it could happen. We're not even speaking of, I've seen it in my mind's eye. We're saying, because I know what God is, because I know who He is and what He's done, I have a relationship with God, and I know, based on His characteristics and His promises, that my Redeemer lives. Now, the word Redeemer is the word Goel. It's used in the book of Ruth for what Boaz was to Naomi, and because Ruth and Naomi were now related in a covenant, Boaz to Ruth. It can be one of two things. It can be the kinsman redeemer, which is the near relative who will buy back a family member from slavery, from being a prisoner of war, who will bail someone out of trouble, who will pay their debts. It's that rich Uncle Harry that comes to the defense. Or, in the case of severe wrongdoing, it can be the blood avenger. And by that, if a family member were killed, this family member would trace down the murderer and avenge that blood by death. Now, if we're in a context on judgment, it's the blood avenger. If we're in a context on redemption, It's the near kinsman. So here is another example of a family term used to describe God. Now, I think that's very important. Now, the word lives here. From Exodus chapter 3, verses 12 through 14, we know that God revealed a brand new name to Moses. Now, the patriarchs, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, had known God by the phrase El, that's the word for God, Shaddai, God Almighty. But when Moses said, "What is your name that I will tell them who sent me?" And out of the burning bush, God answers, "I am that I am," is in your translation of Exodus 3:14. I will be what I will be. I cause to be what I will. Basically, it is the Hebrew verb to be. And so its emphasis is on the ever-livingness of God. I think the only living, the ever-living, creator, redeemer, unique God is what we're talking about. And that's what the word live reflects here. Then it says, "And at last he will take his stand on the earth." Now, I don't understand a whole lot about this little passage, but I know this. Job expected God physically and himself physically to work out this problem somewhere. Now, if it wasn't going to happen in this age, in this life, because Job is expecting to die, if it's not going to happen here, Job believes it's going to happen there. And this really is the first key to our understanding the intellectual, theological, and philosophical problem of why do the righteous suffer and the wicked prosper in this age. Well, brothers and sisters, we have to realize that sometimes the good die young. And sometimes the bad are the rich, wealthy, influential people who live a long time. Why is this? Well, this has been the question that through the years has bothered people. And Job's basic answer, as Psalm 73 and other places in the Old Testament struggle, this says, God is just. God can be depended on. If he does not solve it in justice here, he must solve it in justice there, or he is an unjust God. And so Job is saying, I don't know when, I don't know where, I don't know how, but God physically and I physically are going to somehow bring justice into my life. Now, let's look at the next one. Even after my skin is, now mine has flayed. The Hebrew is they consumed. Now, we're probably talking about the worms that are the bacteria that eat the body after death. And that's the idea here in Hebrew. Now, notice the next little phrase. Yet without my flesh, I shall see God. Now, I want you to notice several different translation possibilities here. Okay, look with me. Some translations have, in my flesh, I shall see God. King James, the New International Version. Some translations have, from my flesh, I will see God. Revised Standard Version, Jerusalem Bible. Now others have, without my flesh, I will see God, which is the American Standard and the New American Standard. Now, my translation, I use New American Standard in the Old Testament, is saying, without my flesh, I'll see God. And what Job is saying, if that's an accurate translation, he's saying, when I die and go to Sheol, and in that shade, that shadow, that incomplete existence, there God will give me justice. I will see God after death if it means without my flesh. If it means in my flesh, it's another emphasis that somewhere, somehow, in a physical existence, God will give me justice. Now, notice the word see in verse 26, verse 27. Behold, my eyes shall see. There is a real emphasis here on the physical aspect. And so I want to give you a list real quick of some of the places in the Old Testament that I believe do speak of an afterlife. Now, when Jesus was speaking, he used some rather obtuse examples. He went back to Exodus chapter 3 where it says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Jesus would say in the New Testament, he was not in the past the God. He is currently the God. Therefore, they're still alive. And that's a pretty oblique one. I certainly think it's true because Jesus used it. But I would never have seen that there probably. Let me give you some ones that I can see pretty readily that speak of an afterlife, even if it's not clear what it involves, even if it's not clear when or how or who or all of that, it does speak of an afterlife. Psalms 16, 9 through 11, Psalms 17, 15, Psalms 49, 15, Psalm 73, 23 through 26, and that's the other passage on why the righteous suffer. Proverbs 23, 14, Isaiah 26, 19, and Daniel 12, 2 and 3. So Job is not isolated here in his understanding. Many say this can't mean resurrection because Job is too early. The setting of Job is a patriarchal setting, sometime around the life of Abraham. But I do believe that this hope of a life hereafter began to develop very early, maybe because of injustice here, maybe because of God's promises that seem to go beyond the grave. I don't know. But I do think it's not unfortunate to read it in this text. I think it's applicable. Now then it says, whom my eyes shall see and not another. Now, by the way, I want to add chapter 14, verses 14 and 15 to this thing about without my flesh I will see God. And now not another. That's rather poor translation here. He's not saying I'm going to see God and nobody else is. He's not saying I'm the only one that's going to be resurrected. What he's saying is, and a little more literal Hebrew will help you. Quote, he will not be a stranger. Now that's what it literally says. He will not be a stranger. Now what that means is I'm going to see him and I'm going to know him and I'm going to be able to talk with him and somehow we're going to set this thing straight. And so that's what he's talking about. Now in verses 28 and 29, the closing verse to this helps me see that Job is what he's talking about in verse 25 through 27. The Hebrew is very, very garbled here. The translations are very uncertain, as you can see from looking at several English translations. But Job is saying to his friends, I'm going to stand before God, and I'm going to receive justice. And I want you to know that you're going to stand before God too. You're going to meet him face to face. And I that is a real clue in the fact that Job still expects to see God. Now let's go back and look at this thing in a perspective. We know that God thought that Job was a righteous man. And the evil one attacked his credibility based on the fact that Job only loved God because of what God gave him. And God said no. So the evil one was allowed to take away Job's material blessings, including his children. And Job worked through that. And Satan said to God, well, yeah, but the ultimate test is a man's life. A man will give anything for his life. And God said, touch his body, but don't kill him. So Job was inflicted with some kind of disease. And here he was on the ash heap of society, after being one of the most respected members of this society. And in the dialogue, Job begins to question this. God, I haven't done anything that I know is wrong. Sure, there's some sins in my youth, and there's some sins of ignorance, but God, nothing deserved this. And God, why are you picking on me? It's like you're putting all your energy into picking on me. And so Job really gets his hang up about, I'm innocent. And somehow God is doing this for a purpose, but he didn't know what it is. And by the way, God never tells him about chapters 1 and 2. God never tells him the reason. God never answers Job's question. God deals with his own sovereignty over creation. And Job finally comes to a place of repentance. But these three friends enter in, and they begin to really hit Job with this traditional theology. If you only. Why don't you admit it? On and on. And Job says, guys, that's just not true. That's not accurate to my experience. So here we have traditional theology coming in conflict with Job's personal experience. And the only way Job knows how to answer this is saying, God, I need to have a meeting with you. God, I want to present my case before you. Now, some say it's a legal case, and I think there's some evidence, good evidence for that. But I really don't think Job wants to bring God to trial. I think Job wants a private consultation to say, God, I don't understand. What's happening to me? Why has this come? This isn't the way I thought it was supposed to be. So Job is a very important book in bringing a balance to traditional Old Testament theology. But here's a man who does not understand what's happening, does not understand why it's happening, and is really hurting emotionally, relationally, physically. And he wants to talk to God. Now, as these three friends continue to egg him on, Job gets more and more militant. Now, he gets more militant towards them, and he gets more militant towards God. And this whole book is going to be summed up by God saying, Job, would you make me look bad to vindicate yourself? Would you be willing to put my character on trial that you might assert your innocence? But at this point, Job is still struggling with the stinging accusation of his five friends. Now, it's very important that you have some kind of a commentary to see the outline of this book. The one I like the best, and if you don't have an Old Testament commentary series, Varsity Press puts out Tyndale Old Testament series, which is synonymous with Tyndale's New Testament series. They're all by different authors, but I have found them to be such excellent books. And in that little book on Job, there is a list of these cycles or speeches. And I've told my own church, the most important thing you can do when studying a book is not go to a commentary immediately, but to get several English translations and to read the larger context in your English translation. They're going to differ some. That's okay. And then outline it in your own words. Don't go to a book first, but you try to outline it, not in detail, but by broad outlines. Try to find the prologue where God and Satan talk. Then try to find chapter 3 where the disaster hits Job and he wishes he was never born. And then begin to outline these cycles of discussions. Those three friends are going to speak. Eliphaz, Bildad, Zophar. See how they speak and Job answers. Outline those speeches by chapters and verse divisions. I think it'll amaze you how this book outlines so well. And then you're going to get back into Job's monologues, beginning in about a verse 28. Job's last response is 27. In 28 is an independent monologue on wisdom. And then 29 through 31 is Job's monologue response, the past, the present, his pledge of innocence. And then we move into Elihu. And then Job's going to answer again, and then God's going to answer, and it is beautiful. But, ladies and gentlemen, do it yourself first. Don't allow me or anybody else to influence you before you and the Holy Spirit have a time to be with this book. So read it in several English translations, outline in your own words, and then go to a good commentary. I think this Tyndale Old Testament series is probably one of the best on the book of Job. And then look and see what they say. Always remember, last time we're doing chapter 19, make sure you see this chapter in the literary whole. Make sure you read the chapter going in and the chapter going out and you see the big picture before you start interpreting this to your people. Make sure you look up the parallel passages. See if there are some other responses, like chapter 16 is very similar to 19. Chapter 19 is a reaction to chapter 18. You need to see that before you begin to interpret it. Look up parallels. For these difficult words like the kinsman redeemer, the goel, look up parallel passages throughout the Bible and try to get those locked into place. The concepts like the book of remembrances will be very helpful to you. And then don't just quit at 19, but go ahead and read 20 and see how it fits into a whole. And make sure whatever you do to interpret this in light of context. Now, a good example of that is verse 20, where the little phrase, by the skin of my teeth, is totally different in context from what it is the way we normally use it. And we're guilty of that. We're guilty of reading the Bible as if it was the morning newspaper, reading our definitions into it, reading our culture into it, without remembering that we must interpret the Bible in light of its culture and its day. So this is a perfect example of that. Of what the Bible's saying, not meaning what we've made it to say. And you've got to be very careful. Verses 25 through 27 is a classic verse. But we must not read full-blown New Testament theology into Old Testament text. Now, they can be an incipient form there, but make sure that that Job is saying what you think he's saying. Quite often, we just try to proof text the Bible to back up our theology. Let Job speak in the context of his own day first. And then apply that thread of resurrection through Scripture that ultimately culminates in the hope that's in Jesus Christ. So the New Testament is really based on these incipient truths in the Old Testament, and this is a classical one. Well, there's such hope here in the middle of this man's pain, middle of this man's problem, in the midst of his denial and incensed over being hurt by God innocently. There's hope. And this man fluctuates from great hope to great despair. So do I. Don't you? We're creatures of both doubt and faith in everything. And there's Job right there saying, though I'm hurting, I know I'm going to see Him. I know He's going to give me justice. I know He's going to be for me. And that's what we have here. This is a great chapter. I've enjoyed being with you. I'll see you again, same time, same place.